This is Professor Philip Kotler, and I have the pleasure of being invited to give a talk to the Wellness and Well-Being Summit. Most of my life, I've been working on how to make the world a better place for all the people in the world, not just a few. And in fact, I recently finished a biography, autobiography called My Life as a Humanist. So when I got the invitation to talk to about wellness and well-being, I thought I would talk about the way our society affects our wellness and well-being. Namely, are we living in a democracy or not? Are we living with good capitalism or not? Because those systems, those very large political and economic systems, affect how much our well-being will be and our wellness. So I want to start by moving to my first slide. And, you know, we are coming to a fork in the road. Times are very tough and fragile and uncertain. Some people go and say, we're either facing extinction or hopefully utopia. By the way, it's not going to be a utopia, but we hope it isn't extinction. And what's the best system for well-being? Is it the American capitalist system, which certainly got a reputation historically for being the best place to grow up and have high opportunities and maybe good income, if not wealth, too? I would make the case that American capitalism needs to be improved. And I'll show you the reasons. And that there's another capitalism which we should move to, called Nordic capitalism. Nordic means, of course, the Scandinavian countries. They include five countries, Sweden, Denmark, Finland, Norway, and Iceland. And I want to state that those countries produce much better wellness and well-being. And I'll demonstrate that. But certainly American capitalism needs to change. Yes, we have the world's highest GDP, but even then, we have to understand that GDP is just a measure of how much was produced by us and not how happy we are about it or whether our well-being was helped or injured by that. I'll get into that. But notice that there are scores for our happiness too. Yes, we have the highest GDP, but our gross national happiness ranks at 19 in the world. That's not very encouraging. And our gross national health, and let's take that to be a measure of welfare and well-being, is at 13. Even Canada, our neighbor to the north, consists of happier and healthier people. So we have to think about this. In fact, there are problems with our capitalism in its present form. We are experiencing a shrinking middle class. Yes, we have the most billionaires in the world, but we also have many, many poor people who shouldn't really have to be poor. We have many young people who cannot go to college because the cost of a four-year degree might be as high as $200,000, especially if we're talking about the Ivy League colleges, or if we're of course, if it's community colleges, you'll get a good education, but it won't be that expensive. The result is many young people don't go to college. And if they go, are they better off? They come out with a huge debt. Now, many families have an illness that strikes or surgery that costs them $50,000 or more. That wipes out their savings, especially if they couldn't afford insurance. That isn't good at all. And many families have to think twice about having a family, a baby, because even from the time that the birth started to the time the baby's delivered might have caused a set of costs, seeing the physicians, eating a different way, et cetera, that might amount to $20,000. And then if the baby is actually born and delivered, a family will spend somewhere between $175,000 and $372,000, depending on the income level, to raise a child from infancy to age 17. No wonder fewer babies are being born in the United States. So let's go and see what we can do about that. Okay. Let's go to GDP again. A GDP, gross domestic product, is only a measure of the total value of the country's economic output during that year, during a year, really. And now it includes negative things too. I mean, the more cigarettes, the higher the GDP, the more whiskey, the more unhealthy food. So remember that not all things we produce are health oriented. There are actually a number of things that are health destructive. GDP doesn't even include the value of household work and child raising. Yes, it's true, we don't pay the wives to specific sums of money reported as income for their unpaid labor. But we might want to consider a system where the woman can go to work and someone else could be hired to take care of the child while the mother's at work, and therefore pay someone. And the question is, will the government treat this as a legitimate expense to help the woman go to work or not? The other thing is that GDP does not measure the human effort and hours that went into production and whether they were excessive and maybe hurt the health of workers. In other words, we can get even to a higher GDP if we all work not only 8 hours a day, if that's a common, but 12 hours a day. Yeah, you get more GDP, but shouldn't we look at the cost of doing that? So GDP cannot be a trusted measure of outcomes. There's more to measure. And I want to go to this question. How about measuring happiness? Or should we really measure well-being? They're a little different. So let's take each. If you're going to measure happiness, we have to go back to the famous British legislator, Jeremy Bentham, who around 1776 said that happiness can be measured, and he will make the assumption that everyone's happiness is the same as another. If person A has one unit of happiness, he's going to assume that if person B has happiness, it's equal in value. He doesn't want to make judgments of, person A is a better person, and therefore his happiness should be measured higher or more importantly than the other person's. So he took a simple assumption that we will not make comparisons of the happiness levels of different people, but we're going to measure happiness. By the way, he was succeeded by John Stuart Mill, again from Britain, a great philosopher too, who wanted to distinguish between two types of happiness. The kind that most people measure is hedonic happiness, body pleasure. Laughing, feeling good, okay. He also said there's another kind, eudaimonic happiness, which is higher mind. The mind is at peace. The mind is very thoughtful and happy. That distinction, we never made much effort to distinguish between the two, because John Stuart Mill, as a genius, wanted to emphasize the importance of mind pleasure, not just body pleasure. But we'll not make that distinction right now. Maybe it would be better to measure well-being in the sense that the numbers are more easier to measure, because many of them relate to health. Are people living longer? Is there less cancer and less heart disease and so on? Are there less backaches? Well, you can form some indices that you could total and measure these things. And that measure would be called just like GDP is gross national product, this would be gross national wellness. And the higher it is, we would believe that it's expressing the fact that more people exercise, they eat healthier foods, and so on. So let's say the gross measure of well-being may be easier to do than the gross measure of happiness, but both of them could make a contribution. So let's go to the Nordic countries, which I mentioned. What's common to them is they all practice economic democracy. They have strong trade unions and collective bargaining, something we had ourselves for so many generations. We had strong unions, and they would bargain and sometimes go on strike, but to be sure, the workers would get their portion of the value created by the companies, because the labor has a value. And the question is all the money going to the investors of the company, or is some really coming into the pockets of working people? So the interesting thing is, in the Nordic countries, they have companies that are successful around the world. You've heard of Volvo, and you've heard of so many big companies from Sweden and Finland and Denmark. They're global companies. They make enough of a profit to operate successfully, and yet they deal with unions. In fact, take Germany, for example, which is not a Nordic country, but close to them. In Germany, the labor group has half the representatives on the board of directors, something like that. In other words, labor has a role in shaping the company's policies. They're on the board of directors to make sure that labor's getting a good deal out of the strategy. Okay, now all Nordic countries enjoy the highest living standards. These have been measured. One way to put it is this: go to any study that says it is measuring the level of wellness in that country, or it's measuring the level of happiness in that country, or it's measuring the level of income equality as opposed to inequality. In all those cases, take the top 10 countries, the top 10 in those three different rankings. You will always find all five Nordic countries in the list of the top 10, and many just at the very 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, they will be highest in well-being and highest in happiness. Whereas the U.S. ranking in happiness, as I said earlier, is number 19. we're actually at 13 in the world by in 2012, but things got worse. And our ranking in healthcare is 13. But being 13, what's embarrassing is that we spend in the United States 17% of our GDP on health. The big other major countries, they are only spending 12% of their GDP on health. And the health systems are very good. As I said, in the Nordic countries, the health systems are better than ours in the United States. Okay, what does this mean about our capitalism and Nordic capitalism? Well, let's take the main features and benefits that people have when they live in the Nordic countries. Free college. There are some fees occasionally, but they're minor compared to the fact that there's no big $200,000 four-year college bite on people attending. In fact, there's one university in Europe, I'm trying to remember which one, where they invite people from other countries to come and have free college. Also, free and excellent healthcare. Everyone's covered. Everyone will be taken care of when they're sick. A much longer worker vacation time. Go to Italy, for example, go back to the Nordic countries. Italy may be a little extravagant because it's sort of 7 weeks off the year, but it's more than 2 weeks off in the Nordic countries. There's more time and less pressure on the citizens of the Nordic countries. Maternity and paternity benefits apply in all five Nordic countries. When the woman is pregnant and needs medical care and during birth and so on, and even the husband is urged to be off of work after the baby is born for some weeks too. Child care. And aged parents care. Now, remember, one of the problems is a family in their age group of about 40 or 45 with some children, they have to take care of their children and their parents are getting older. So they're trying to benefit. They don't have really often the money it takes to take care. You're 40 years or 50 years old, and you want to take care of your children, you want to take care of your parents. Now, the Nordic idea is to make a good life for all citizens. And now, here's the only negative. You have to pay higher taxes. Sure, because it's costly to do that. In Sweden, the tax rate may be 70%. And maybe that means for the high income group. They use graduated income tax systems. So if you have an average or a low income, you're not paying 70%. But the top bracket pays 70%. That is the last amount in that top bracket. The earner only keeps 30% of that because 70% goes to the government. Okay. So the point is that studies have been made with blind testing where you say, would you like to live in country A or B? And they don't name the countries. A has a system of free college, free health, et cetera, et cetera. But the top tax rate is 70%. B has few of these things, and the top rate is 40%. And especially the young people who are asked this question in college, they favor the Nordic system. They'd rather pay higher taxes and make sure that everyone is getting all these benefits. Well, does anyone recommend that for the United States? Is this all idealistic with no role being played by this idea of Nordic capitalism in the United States? Well, the answer is no. We have in the Democratic Party two groups, and one of the groups is called the Progressive Group. And that group believes in pretty much Nordic capitalism. Let's move on. Look at what Bernie Sanders wants, the Senator Bernie Sanders, and also his colleague, Senator Elizabeth Warren. They want higher taxes. In fact, they are in favor of a higher wealth, of the creation of a wealth tax as well, and also higher estate taxes. So when people pass away, more of their property, especially if they had tremendous property, goes back to the state. Okay. So let's just see what Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren say. They want Medicare for all. That is not for it's not, it's called a single payer system. Everyone is covered. College should be free. Wages must rise to a living or livable level. Unions should have a stronger presence and a voice. There should be free childcare and pre-K education for the kids under five, maybe starting at three or four. Invest more in public education. Raise tax rates on the rich. Women's rights have to be strengthened and toward what we call gender equality, that a woman and a man performing the same work would get equal pay, and racial justice. So it looks like we have a large group in the United States wanting Nordic capitalism. Let's move on. We are also a country with a huge number, the largest number of billionaires. 724 billionaires are American citizens. By the way, China, of all communist countries, which shows they're not communistic, has 698 billionaires. But then Germany has 110, Russia 102. Well, Russia may not have 102 anymore because of what's happening. India has some, and so on. I don't have anything on Turkey and some other countries. But the main thing is, overall, there's about 2,800 billionaires. And that's not even counting royal people, where we can't even get a sense of what Queen Elizabeth owns, or dictators, or mafia, or criminals. So why do I make this point? The point is that the billionaires of the world account for something like $13 trillion. Trillion, not billion. Why can't we tax them more? Why can't we put out a wealth tax, which is small amount, let's say 1% of your wealth, leaving 99% for the next year? So, there's a lot of talk about that. Bill Gates came up with a wonderful idea, along with his friend Warren Buffett, and said, we are billionaires. That is, Gates and Buffett are billionaires. And they said, there's a real problem. Let's get other billionaires to start giving away more money. Wouldn't it be nice if we could get some billionaire to just pledge that he or she will give away at least half of their wealth during the next 10 years to good causes. And not so much buying and owning a stadium, probably to people who are poor, who have poor housing, and so on. So it's called the Giving Pledge. The good news is there's now at least 211 billionaires who signed up, and they come from 23 countries. And just go to the internet and put in the word, the Giving Pledge, and you will see actually the pictures of the billionaires who have agreed to do that. Now, I think 211 billionaires is a very small number, considering that in the United States, we have 698 billionaires. So we're not tapping into the $13 trillion in their hands, but it's a start. There are some billionaires, this is very interesting, just a few, but they also favor paying more. They want to pay more. That, of course, those who signed the Giving Pledge are included in that. There's a fellow named Nick Hanauer. He says to the other billionaires, and he's one himself, beware, fellow plutocrats. The pitchforks are coming. He's almost saying, you better live in a guarded community. You better have your own army, because the poor, if they get poor enough, they're going to come and do what happened in Russia when they took over the Tsar and the Tsar's family and killed them all. So he scares billionaires, and he should. A guy named Ray Dalio, a very wealthy man, founder of a hedge fund called Bridgewater Associates, is very interested in seeing more money flowing to the poor people at the lower income level. And he's told other billionaires to do that. Mark Benyon, I know a little better. He is the CEO of the company called Salesforce, which is in San Francisco. And he wants always all the rich people to help out to solve the social problems. Now, for example, one very big problem in San Francisco is homelessness. It's almost, Mark says, it's embarrassing how this beautiful city doesn't look beautiful anymore because there's so many people who are homeless. And he went to all the other big companies in San Francisco and ask them to pull in their money to build housing and to help the homeless people. So that's a good guy. Abigail Disney, who inherited her money from the fabulous fortune of Walt Disney. George Soros, great financial genius. The Pritzkers, and some others all favor a moderate wealth tax. Please tax me. I don't mind if you will use the money well. By the way, I think the issue is partly this, that a lot of us would want to be paying higher taxes as long as we know it's going for better education or better health. If it's going for more defense, or some other ways where we don't, you know, who needs another battleship? Then we may give more confidence to the billionaires to pay a higher tax if they can be sure that it goes for good purposes. Now, recently there was a divorce in the biggest billionaire's family, and it's Jeff Bezos, who runs Amazon, and his wife parted. Jeff apparently met someone who took his mind off of his wife, and they had to settle. And the settlement was $65 billion went to Mackenzie Scott after the divorce. The good news is she is a dynamite. She has given so much of the 60, she still has most of it, but she will give $6 billion here and $5 billion there to good causes. And maybe we have to revise our tax policies. And there are many people who head companies now who are very social in their thinking. Paul Polman had headed the company called Unilever and did a marvelous performance in that company. And he talks about this. Indra Nui, she is from India, but she ran Pepsi-Cola. And she is much in favor of higher taxes and so on. Muhammad Yunus, the great man in who got a Nobel Prize for thinking of the idea of giving women in Bangladesh a cell phone so that they could be salespeople. They could help sell phone calls and help sell other things to people who have no ways to connect with businesses and so on. But he has put so many women to work in ways that they are earning, in ways they could leave the low paying rural areas and be in the cities and earn some money. Mr. Tata from India, and is also a man who is very much a conscience of India. Okay, let me move on. Here's what it takes. We need new tax policies. And I'm just going to cite what they are. Raise the top tax rate on the rich. Maybe not at the 70%. And this is the highest bracket. It's not the average. Raise it to 50%. Right now, it's only 37%. And that's such a giveaway to the rich. Increase the estate tax. Increase the capital gain. You know, start taxing capital gains. If you are an investor and you own some stock and you got some income and you held the stock for more than a year, your tax on your profits was 15%. That's very low. Why not make it just ordinary income? You were lucky. You chose some good stocks. You made some money and pay your income, your ordinary income tax, not 15%. By the way, it's not 15% anymore. It's around 22%. Still below average incomes. Close the tax loopholes and hideaways. You know, money is hidden all over the world. It's hidden in Russia. It's hidden in Montana. In fact, a book came out recently called American Kleptocracy. Kleptocracy, that means stealing, basically. And we have our own systems where the rich can put their money and no one will know about it and they're not going to be taxed. And establish, as European countries have often done, luxury taxes on homes and expensive cars. If someone builds a mansion or gets a Rolls Royce, how about higher taxes? See, they can afford those higher taxes. Okay, those are some tax policies that may allow us to have freer college education and freer healthcare. What needs to be done? American industry will still be based on private ownership, and the aim will be good profits, hopefully through what we call stakeholder capitalism, not shareholder capitalism. Namely, we had a professor named Milton Friedman, and I studied under him at the University of Chicago, who said the goal of a company is profit to go to the investors, as if it didn't matter. There were labor people and other groups that make up a company. That was called shareholder capitalism. And no wonder people at work were moody, not motivated, not working hard for the low incomes they were getting. So we have pushed the idea of stakeholder capitalism, that that a company would be smarter and more successful to pay good wages, good amounts to invest in communities where they are selling their goods and services, to invest in sustainability, namely to make sure that the planet doesn't warm up. It's a broader view of the purpose of business. And there's pretty good movement toward stakeholder capitalism, which is getting closer to Nordic capitalism. Secondly, American companies and wealthy Americans will have to pay higher taxes. Third, American companies will have to accept unions and give a policy voice to their employees. And fourth, my future prediction that if we take the Nordic fork in the road, Americans will be happier and healthier people. So that is my message to our listeners, that it is not it's not just idealism. Everything I said is factually based and based on what is possible. I wish we could put it to a vote. Even if we got the right vote, it wouldn't be implemented immediately, but it takes time to move the society to the Nordic ideals. However, I think it would be the best investment we could make in enhancing the wellness and the well-being of our citizens in this country. Thank you very much, and feel free to discuss and debate any of these ideas. Take care. This is Philip Kotler signing off. Thank you.